Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives regarding diversity, equity, and inclusion. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with your hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gully and Ted Madden.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, and thanks as always for listening. This week we'll have part two of our conversation with former WFAA sports commentator Dale Hansen. I worked with him for 14 years, and I marveled at his talent as a writer. He could say more with less than anyone I've ever seen. No one wrote as clearly and as concisely as he did, and no one could communicate it in such a way where the viewers didn't miss a word. In the last several years of his career, he had a lot of things to say, and he said them with his Hansen Unplugged commentaries. We'll pick up part two from where we left off last week.
Okay, we left off with our wonderful guest, Mr. Dale Hansen, talking about affirmative action. And so what I really want to say on that is that I think what is really amazing is that we have so many people that do not even understand that when it comes to that particular federal program, the benefactors of affirmative action, you know, are actually white women. And that is, I mean, in every statistic, it's very clear and just to the point. And so I think that oftentimes we get a lot of information that is actually misinformation.
And well, I think the biggest part of the misinformation, though, to me is that they always equate affirmative action with unqualified or not as qualified.
Yes.
And I've never known anybody that says that. I mean, the people that are doing the hiring. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I would hire a person of color, it was never based on, well, I know you're not as good at this, you're not as good at that, you can't do this, you can't do that. No, that was never. You had to meet every other single criteria. And I think that's true in almost every hiring program in America. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody sits down and says, well, we're gonna give the contract to this minority-owned company because they're inferior. No. Right. You're going to give it to the minority-owned company because they've been shut out of the process for so long. We have to have a quota. We have to have an affirmative action to lift the boat. But they also have to be good, efficient,
absolutely,
thorough, safe, you know, whatever the criteria for the job is. And it's always that way, though. Mm-hmm. Almost every time I hear somebody talk about affirmative action, they always go immediately to the next point of, well, that means we're going to hire less qualified people. Mm-hmm. Nobody does that. Nobody has ever said that, except the people who are critical of affirmative action, because they somehow think that they're getting the short end of the stick. And that's what a lot of our politics has become now, that they turn it into, well, you know, it's the white guys being discriminated against. Really? I mean, really? If the occasional white guy has to lose out on a job, I think they'll be okay, you know, because they've certainly been okay for 200 plus years. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how else you fix it other than this. If somebody can come up with a better way to fix it than affirmative action and quotas, as much as most people hate that word, mm-hmm, I'm all ears. Yeah. Explain it to me. But nobody ever has.
Well, as a person who lost 8 jobs of the 11, I wanted to ask you, and landing here in Dallas, what has that meant to you to end up here in Dallas, Texas, and live?
Well, it's meant everything. I mean, but it's meant a couple of things. I mean, it meant the very basic thing of I never give up. I mean, that's the one thing that, for whatever reason, I think maybe my dad scared me into believing that. I mean, I couldn't go home and tell my dad that I had failed. I was afraid to. I mean, physically afraid to go home and tell my dad that I had failed. So every time I got fired, I went, oh, this is going to be bad. You know, this is good. But I was never out of work for very long. Mm-hmm. The longest that I was ever out of work is when I got fired in Omaha And then before I got hired in Dallas the first time, I was unemployed for about 4 months. And that was getting a little iffy. I was turned down at 112 stations. I actually sent my tape and resume out to 112 TV stations that wrote back, if they wrote back, nope, not interested, nope, not interested, you know. And I was just about ready to give up. And my girlfriend at the time, who's now been my wife for 40 years, we're at a party, and this guy wanted me to work at his department store. And he said, well, you got a great gift of gab, and you got a good personality. Why don't you come sell shoes at my department store? And I said, sure, I'll do that. And Chris leans across, I'll never forget it, Chris leans across the table, grabs my hand, and said, no, he's not coming to work. He's a sportscaster. I said, well, yeah, baby. I said, but I'll just take that job because I'm making no money. And he goes, no, if you took that job, you get sidetracked from chasing your real job. So no, sir, he will not be at your store Monday. I got hired the next week.
Wow.
I got hired the next week to come to Dallas. But that was about as close as I got to giving up. But when I finally ended up in Dallas, I think it just kind of reinforced a lot of what I believed in. And I kind of start from this premise. There's an old, although I was researching this just to see if I could make sure I had it right. And so there's an argument about who actually said it, but it doesn't matter because I think it's brilliant. As long as Hitler didn't say it, of course, I'd feel bad about that. But it's an old Persian proverb is what I've always been told about. I complained because I had no shoes until I saw a man who had no feet. And that's me in a nutshell.
So here we are 70 plus years later. What have you learned and what can you share with our younger listeners about how this life works?
Well, there's a couple of things that I do believe it is. I always said before that Persian proverb drives me every day. But the other aspect of my life that really did settle me down, and it came a little bit too late in my life on the one hand, but there was a great movie called Bridge of Spies. At least I think it was a great movie. It didn't ever seem to get the bang that I thought it should have. But it was a Steven Spielberg movie starring Tom Hanks. And it's a true story of this Russian spy, Rudolf Abel. And Rudolf Abel is on trial in America for treason, facing the death penalty. And Tom Hanks was the lawyer, William Donovan, some Donovan. And I'll never forget this. And it's early in the movie, and Tom Hanks looks at Rudolf Abel and he says, you're facing the death penalty and you're probably going to be convicted because you're a spy and you're going to get the death penalty. And he said, you don't seem worried. Are you worried? And Rudolf Abel looks at him and says, would it help? And I'm watching the movie and I thought, wow. Now, I don't know if that actually happened or not, but I don't care. Well, that became the theme all the way through the movie. So at the end of the movie, and there's no spoiler here because it's a simple fact of life, but they're exchanging Rudolf Abel. The Americans are exchanging him for an American spy named Francis Gary Powers, who was flying the plane that got shot down over Russia in 1959. So they're at this bridge, and that's why they call it Bridge of Spies, and they're going to make the exchange. And Tom Hanks looks at Rudolf Abel, and he goes, how do you think the Russians will receive you after being in American captivity for the last couple of years? He goes, well, if they put me in the front seat, they're probably going to kill me. And if they put me in the back seat, I'll be fine. He goes, are you worried? He goes, would it help? And for the last 12, I think that movie came out in like 2010, 2009. For the last 12, 13 years of my life, that's why I live every day. Every day, I go to the doctor. They show me this x-ray, and I know that's a brain tumor. What am I going to do about it? You know, should I get worried about it? I had to take a test recently, and he said, well, it could be tuberculosis. I don't have to tell you that. I said, no, you don't. You really don't. He said, well, no, you need to know. I said, no, I don't need to know. I mean, and I swear to you, he's like, well, don't worry about it. I go, would it help? And Chris just starts laughing. He's like, and the doctor looks at me like, that's a long story. But you have to approach that, and then you have to approach life with an understanding of opening up your eyes and ears to the world around you. I think it's one of the problems. I think it's a negative result of what I thought was a positive idea at the time when we eliminated the draft. Now, this will never pass again. Under no circumstances could I run for office and get this on the ballot. But I think one of the biggest mistakes we made as America was when we eliminated the draft, which I was incredibly in favor of. I was marching in the streets to get rid of the draft. And now I look back and I think that's one of the biggest mistakes we made. And I wish we could reinstitute the draft. Not necessarily to serve in the Army or the Air Force or Navy like I did. But I think everybody in America owes this country 2 years. Whether it's building homes, whether it's sweeping the streets, whether it's stocking shelves at the food bank, whether it is serving in the military, you adjust the pay for different jobs. All of it minimum pay across the board. I made $94 a month, and I had a child. Mm-hmm. When I was in the Navy, and then they said, well, no, if you got a child, we'll kick in like $7. And then, oh, you're going to live off base, we'll kick in another $8. You know, so I was up to... You struggled every day. I was in for 3 years. But it opened my eyes up to everything that I believe. And if you had taken the draft out, I would have never gone to the draft. I'm obviously not going to the draft in 1967 at the height of the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. I would have never met all these kids from California and Florida, New York, Montana. I don't think I ever met anybody in Idaho, because I don't think anybody lives there. I've heard about it. I don't think there's anybody there. And then I went to the Dominican Republic, and I spent time in San Juan and Aruba, meeting, you know, all these different cultures and walks of life. And it changed my life. I mean, they do this in Israel. They do this in South Korea, where you owe, and I think it's a small price to pay. Everybody in this country owes the country 2 years. And I think it would change everything. Because then you're gonna be building a home next to a guy from New York City. You're gonna be building a home next to a guy from Compton, California. You're gonna be building a home next to a guy from Iowa, Texas. Join the Peace Corps. We throw in a few more bucks. Oh, now you're really learning something about the world. And if young people would just get involved with that and realize that the whole world, and I think that's part of our problem, you know, now it's all the Instagrams and the Facebook pictures, and, you know, it's all about me, 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 me. And I'm like, I don't want to see what you had for breakfast this morning. I don't care where you went on vacation. I don't care that you got a cute dog. I just don't, you know. Mike Leslie does, apparently. That's all he does. But I just think that we've all, and everybody said to me, well, that's easy for you to say because you've always had that public platform. And I don't know if that's true or not, but maybe, you know, maybe. They said, well, yeah, you know, you don't worry about people recognizing and knowing you because they do, because of the platform that I had. But I don't, as you know, I don't tweet, I don't do that. And I just wish people would realize that, you know, we all die, we all live. Oh, by the way, 18 is not the end-all, be-all, you know? It's an old adage, but it's true. I really do wish that I could do it all over again, knowing what I know now. Because I did a lot of stupid stuff and made a lot of really bad decisions, and I'd like to eliminate those. At the same time, I wouldn't change much about my life. Because I always found the happiness in everything. And I think that's the other bottom line, is that I make an absolute point to laugh about something every day. Now, that gets me in trouble a lot, because as Ted, you well know, I have this, I think, as I've said many times, the best thing about me is I have the ability to laugh at everything. And the worst thing about me is I have the ability to laugh at everything. But I do. And I don't, you can't offend me. I might roll my eyes and go, oh my gosh, but if it's funny, I'll laugh. I mean, I will, I just will. But I laugh every day. And I realize that at the end of the day, and you know, nobody cares what award I got, how much money I made or didn't, you know, nobody cares. We all die. We all end up in the same place. So when I hit those occasional bumps along the way, and some of them were huge bumps, I was able to roll with it, mm-hmm. because I'm like, as compared to what? And that's what I always said to my daughter and my granddaughter. Whenever they would call me and complain about something in their life, I'm like, as compared to what? You know, you don't like your job. How about the family that doesn't have a job? Mm. You know, you're overweight because you can't lose weight. Really? That, you know, what about the person that dies young of cancer? I mean, it's maybe corny, maybe trite. But every time something hits me in the face, I go, compared to what?
We're always looking up and not looking down. We're comparing ourselves. We're looking up at the job we don't have, the house that isn't big enough, the cars we're not driving. And we never look down and say, you know what, I'm doing pretty good.
I think that's
and
exactly
it's healthy
right.
To look, it's healthy to look both ways.
Well, and it is somewhat true. It's always the grass is greener, you know,
yes.
Whatever. And I, for whatever reason, people find this hard to believe, but when I got the job in Newton, Iowa, I thought I was going to die in Newton, Iowa. And then I got fired, and I move around. And then when I got fired in Omaha, Nebraska, or when I got the job in Omaha, Nebraska, I thought, okay, well, this is a great place to die. I love the, you know, okay, Dallas, you know, Texas, you know. I never thought, you know, in terms of, well, I need to get to ESPN. I need to get to that job. I never had that because in all seriousness, while people don't necessarily believe this about me, but I'm a big believer in the Peter principle. Are you familiar with it? You know, that people are always striving to get to that next level until they fail. They never find happiness and comfort. So this theory is that you're always pushing to go to that next level until you fail. And then the reality is once you fail at that job, you don't just step back. You fall all the way down the ladder again. And believe it or not, I've always been that person like, wow, I don't know how I got this job, but let's try to hang on to this. And they go, well, you got to go to ESPN. You got to go. Nah, well, one, I didn't want to, for starters. Mm-hmm. But no, I go to ESPN, which I'm sure without a doubt I would have failed. Because I don't care if Philadelphia beats Washington. I had enough trouble acting like I cared if the Mavericks were playing. You know, and I didn't care if the Stars were playing. You know,
it's well documented.
Yeah,
you didn't care about the Stars.
But yeah, I care about the personalities. I care about the storylines, like your stories, that kind of thing. But I knew that if I would eventually fail. So when I found that comfort zone, I'm good now. I'm good. And I think that's, people will tell you this, not the people, the person who fired me, but there are people in Newton, Iowa to this day. Because I just went back about 3 years ago for, I used to broadcast a semi-pro football team. And they had like a 45-year reunion and they invited me back. And I haven't talked to those guys in, some of them, I haven't talked to them in 30 years. And they invited me back for their reunion. Because, as they said to me, man, you hated leaving Newton, Iowa, didn't you? you hate it. Yeah, it's been hard, but I'm trying to get over it as best I can. You know? And people, I got friends of mine in Omaha, Nebraska, like, oh, I know you like Dallas, but, well, you loved Omaha. I said, well, yeah, I'm struggling, but it's all right, you know. Because I guarantee you, and I'm pretty sure I told you this, and I know I've told everybody I work with, the one mistake that young people make is just what you're talking about. They're always looking up to the next one. And I worked with a guy, I usually remember his name, but it's blank now, but in Knoxville, Iowa. He was 10 times better sportscaster than I would ever dream of being. This guy was so smart, so good, but he'd go on the air and he'd be doing a high school game and he'd just go through the motions. I did the high school girls basketball game, and they would have thought it was the WNBA finals. I mean, I did my, I was prepared. I had stories. I would interview players. I'd drop in sound. Can we put it on a tape? I'd drop in sound bites. It was a production because there was only one thing I cared about, and that was being the best that I could be on that particular job. And if I go, and you've seen this, Ted, if I go to a banquet and there's 42 people sitting there, I will cuss and complain all the way there. Then they laugh at that first joke. Now I'm hard to get off the stage. And then I cuss and complain all the way home. So why did I speak to 42 people at the Mesquite Rotary Club? Why did I do that? But once I'm there, they're going to get my best shot. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing I'm saying about Newton, Iowa, Knoxville, Iowa, KMTV in Omaha, Nebraska. I just knew I was better than Omaha, Nebraska. I just knew there was something else I could do. And I always wanted to be in a warm city, and I always wanted to be in a major league city. Never thought I would, quite honestly. I swear to you, I never thought I would, which is why I didn't send out tapes. I got a couple of job calls, but I never sent out tapes looking for that next job. Never did it in Dallas. then I finally got to Dallas and said, well, okay, now we're done. Now we're done. Hmm. But people in Newton, Iowa, and KMTV in Omaha, Nebraska will tell you to this day, yeah, it worked out well for him in Dallas, but he was really upset about having to leave Newton and Omaha. And I think too many people make that mistake. I mean, you've seen that. You know that. Oh, yeah. Too many people come to our station thinking, yeah, but when I get on the networks, when I get on ESPN, I'm going to be really good. And that's what this guy, gosh, I wish it would have been something Brown. And Steve Brown. And I mean, he was tremendous. He could have been. And he goes, but it was so funny. In hindsight, well, if I ever get, when I get hired in Chicago or Des Moines or Omaha, then I'll really pick it up. And I'm like, and I said to him, how are they going to hire you? Because all they can do is go by what you're doing on the air now. And what you're doing on the air now is boring. So they're not, you know, and if they call me for a recommendation, I'm going to have to tell them, it's horrible, you know. He says he'll be better, but he's horrible. Yeah. And I swear to you, about 10 years ago, he was still in Knoxville, Iowa. Mm-hmm. And he's doing the, what do you call those mini cart, go-kart type racetrack they got in Knoxville, Iowa?
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's the voice of that.
Well, there you go. Yeah.
And again, hopefully he's happy.
Yeah.
But he could have done everything I've done. I mean, he easily could have done everything I did. But they never find satisfaction. And I think this is more so today. More so today for young people. They're never satisfied with what they have. Now, again, that's fine. You know, you want to push yourself. You want to strive for greatness. But find the happiness. Find it somewhere, because I know it's there.
Yes.
But more importantly, you have to give it everything you've got. Because the only way you're going to move up and get that next job that you think you want is by proving to people just how good you are at this level. Even though you, well, I'm so much better than this. They're not paying me enough, or whatever the argument is. And I guarantee you, I was making $17,000 a year in Omaha, Nebraska. And they offered me $17,500. And I told them I wanted $19,000. We get in a big fight, you know. Then I finally come to Dallas, and I get like $25,000. I thought, how do you spend that kind of money? I mean, how do you even spend $25,000, you know? I was happy. I was as happy in Newton. This is the weirdest thing. I was as happy in Newton, Iowa, covering the Southeast Polk girls basketball team as I've ever been in Dallas, Texas, covering the Cowboys. I love those kids. I love that basketball team. I did the girls state basketball tournament in Iowa, which is like the biggest thing ever, or was, and loved it. Loved it. Got $10 a game and 10 cents a mile. And I went to the Colfax game, and I put in for my expenses, and I put in 11 miles round trip. And John Carl kicked it back and gave me a dollar instead of $1.10 because he says, I've made the drive, and I know it's only $10.
I want to pick up on a thread from part one of our conversation because I left it hanging, okay, about influence. And you were talking about your granddaughter, and you're speaking for her. And we've had this conversation, yeah, right? And, you know, I'm kind of a cynic about, okay, we're trying to do some good things here. We're trying to talk about some important issues. What influence do we really have? And I'm pessimistic about the influence I have. And I'm curious, at even at your level, what influence you think you had?
Very little. I mean, that's I'm every bit as cynical as you are. I saw David Hogue, the young man from Parkland, the Parkland shooting.
Yes.
And he was a big, outspoken opponent of guns and the like after the Parkland shooting. And he was on CNN or MSNBC or something. And they were asking him just that. And he goes, because nothing's changed. You know, you mentioned George Floyd earlier. And I said it then. What we will do is we'll offer thoughts and prayers. And we'll promise to make change. And then we won't. We won't. Now, we might nudge it forward a little bit. But I got in a lot of trouble. I forget if it might have even been the Parkland shooting, quite honestly. That you know, we're going to all stand up and talk about we're going to make this right, we're going to put a stop to it. Well, last year we had more gun shootings in public schools,
yes,
than ever. You know, we set a record last year. And this is like, well, they weren't even in class most of the time. I mean, the kids aren't even in school every day. I mean, back in 1995, you know, you had it Monday through Friday, you could find them there. We had limited classes in 2021, and there were something like 147 shootings. Now, not all, you know, mass killings, whatever, but somebody fired a gun on a school campus like 139 times or, well, 130, let's say 140. How many school days are there?
180.
Right, 180, mm-hmm. and probably not last year.
No,
right?
Probably not.
So let's say you had 160 last year.
Yeah.
So bottom line, almost every day somebody fired a gun. Almost every single day somebody in America fired a gun on a public school. And then that first standard reaction is, well, not going to happen here. No, I'm pretty sure that's what David Hogue said in Parkland. I'm pretty sure those young kids in Newtown, Connecticut, didn't go to school thinking, well, maybe it's us. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's staggering to me. It's staggering. So I sit there and I go, people with more power than me say more incredibly powerful things than I can say, and we still don't move the needle. Mm-hmm. It does knock me down. And then I do. And this is the absolute truth. I get incredibly frustrated. I get angry, quite frankly, but I get more so, I just get frustrated that I can't fix the world.
Yeah.
Because I know I can fix it. If they just listen to me, I can fix it, right? But it's just not going to happen. And so I just want to give up. I just, okay, I'm done. And then I look at McKinsey. I go, well, I can't stop now. I mean, so I've got like four speeches coming up here. I'm speaking to a couple of Democratic parties. I'm speaking to a journalist organization about, in my opinion, the importance of a free media in America, because we're pulling that away too. And I just have to. But I do. It's probably one of the most frustrating things that I do have to deal with is I'll lay this out. I go, well, that's really good. I mean, my most conservative friend, I mean, this hardcore conservative friend of mine, and I've moved him on a couple of issues, and he goes, you're really hard to argue with. I said, well, I hope so. But then I also look at other buddies of mine, and I'll say, well, no, here's my argument. They go, nah. I said, well, no, give me your counter to that. No. Nah. What do you mean no? I mean, you just said that racism's not an issue or homophobia is not an issue. And I just gave you example after, nah, I don't think so. You know, how do you dispute that? How do you change that? Mm-hmm. And I do this speech. In fact, I'm putting it together in a couple weeks. And one of my arguments is, you know, we don't elect leaders anymore. I think that's one of our biggest problems. We don't elect leaders anymore. We elect followers. Mm-hmm. We only elect followers. They follow the polls. They follow the money. And they follow the base. I mean, how's it possible that you put an issue in front of the United States Senate and it's 50-50? Right. There's not three Democrats that went, yeah, I kind of like that. Right. There's not three Republicans. Three. I'm not talking 25.
Right.
You know, no, I think that person's qualified. Yeah. I'm a, what? Mm-hmm. I mean, we used to have, I don't know if we ever had, and of course, they're all so concerned about their jobs. I'll give you, you and I talked about this on the phone the other day, but here's another issue that I'm having. I'm a big supporter of Beto O'Rourke. I like him in so many ways. The first thing he does after he announces that he's running for governor is talking about how much he likes guns, that he really does like guns. He grew up as, you know, I've been around guns. Shut up. You know, not one person who thinks Beto O'Rourke is going to take their guns, which he's not. But not one person in the so-called gun community went, oh, yeah, Beto's kind of rational about that. I'm going to change my vote. But he's lost my enthusiasm. I mean, he's legitimately, I just groaned and I threw up in my mouth when I heard it. Because I thought, oh, really? You're going to be a politician? You really are? And but I want somebody. I want Arnie Vennick from West Wing to run and just say, hey, no, we're not doing this. This is wrong. It's not right for America. Nobody does that anymore. Now, maybe they never did. Maybe they never did. But I like the stories about Tip O'Neill, the congressman from Massachusetts, having dinner with Ronald Reagan, and they'd fight and call each other names. and argue about a bill, and they go, "I'm sorry, did you want dessert with that?
Yeah.
You want an after dinner drink? You know."
Yeah.
And I used to do it with all my friends, and now I still do it with some of my friends. Mm-hmm. But even my liberal friends, I've got conservative friends who've said I'm no longer welcome at their parties. But I've also got liberal friends of mine who don't want the conservatives there. And I'm like, well, no. So I hold court on my patio down in Waxahachie. And for the longest time, I went, okay, well, I can invite so-and-so if I invite so-and-so.
Oh, gosh.
Now, first person to say no, I said, they're just out, mm-hmm. you know. Because I don't like sitting around with everybody who agrees with me. It just bores me. I know I'm right. I wouldn't say it if I didn't believe I was right. I was speaking at the Harvard Club a few months back. And a guy actually came up to me and go, well, I'll tell you this much, you know, you're not always right, but you certainly think you are. I'm like, yeah. I said, don't you? And he kind of, you know, now this is a Harvard guy with a bow tie and everything. And I'm like, well, don't you? I mean, who says anything that they don't think they're right? And then I did say, well, I think there is one difference between you and me. Convince me I'm wrong. Because I will listen. I really will. I watch all the networks. I watch MSNBC. I watch CNN. I watch Fox News. And I watch Fox News right up until I catch him in a bold lie, which usually takes somewhere between 30 and 45 seconds. But I give him a shot. I give him a shot. No, I try to listen. And like on my patio, the best dinner parties I have is when I've got people around me that just don't agree. Mm-hmm. But they're willing to listen. I said, fine, tell me I'm wrong. Sometimes, you know, as soon as they do, I'll change. So, but it just has to be, and I think it used to be that way. I mean, I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure growing up in Logan, Iowa, that they didn't all think like I do, because I didn't think that way. But I was back for my 55th high school reunion a couple of months back. And this buddy of mine, and it was a great question. He came up and he goes, explain something to me. How did two guys grow up in the same community, playing on the same teams with the same teachers, and were 180 degrees opposite from each other? Because he's obviously a very, very conservative guy. And we sat down and we talked about it. Had a night, only to find out, I guess he just blew me up after I left. He just blew me up. And I'm like, what? Oh, okay, fine. But I thought it was kind of an interesting question. Two guys, same community, same teachers, same coaches. Mm-hmm. And I'm over here. And I did. I said to him, did you go to the Navy? He said, no, but I visited a lot of countries. Yeah, he's a big oil guy. Uh-huh. I said, oh, that's right. You visited some of the most diverse countries in the world, staying in the nicest hotels, talking to all those corporate executives about the oil deal that you were doing. I was swabbing the deck on the LST York County, hanging out with all my black friends and my Puerto Rican friends in San Juan. And I'm down. I'm down with the people. And I just think that unless or until we find a way to get people talking to one another and to get people to realize just because you don't think like me doesn't make you a bad person. And that's where we are now. I mean, I don't care. I mean, I really don't. I try to get along with everybody. I mean, I don't care if you're a conservative, vote a straight Republican ticket, or if you're a decent human being. Either one. I'm fine. I'm fine with all of them. You can edit that too.
We'll run that upstairs.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, it just, people are so afraid, and I think it's a basic insecurity of a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And I'm not insecure. I'm a lot of things, but I'm like, when people tell me I'm wrong about something, I don't get upset. No, fine. Teach me. Show me. Explain to me how.
Right.
I can be moved. I can be, you know. Can't think of anything offhand I've changed on lately, but I'm sure I could be, you know. I'm sure I could be.
Well, I'm glad that you posed that question, because within our school district, one of the things that we've looked at so that we can really continue to move in a positive direction and really help our students become the leaders that we feel like they can be by being critical thinkers and not monoliths of other people's thoughts. The other thing that we've done is really work hard with figuring out how do we bring people to the table within our district, because we recognize the fact that we have all types of people here. And they're very opinionated and they have varying ideas. And yet, you know, we want to be able to honor that. And what we have surmised is that at the end of the day, if we can really help people really have that basic understanding of how you honor each other's dignity.
My granddaughter's a teacher, fifth grade teacher in DISD, and okay. Science teacher. And I love this. I started laughing. I said, "You're a science teacher." I said, "What do you know about science?" And she goes, "Way more than everybody in my class." And my daughter was a principal for several years in DISD, and now she is in the administration building, hoping to get back into the principal aspect of it, because she likes the one-on-one stuff instead of moving papers, you know. But I've always said this. I think we lost sight when we... And I'm not trying to tell any teacher how to do your job, and now I will. We spend way too much time worrying about the test results. We spend way too much time arguing about the reading, the writing, and the arithmetic, and all the typical things. We're gonna raise the bar. We're gonna raise this test result. I was a mediocre student. I could have been better, but I just didn't care, because as I've also said a million times, when you're 17 years old, you're never thinking about being 45 with two kids. You know, the only thing I thought about was getting out of high school. I mean, that's the only thing I thought about. So I just kind of sailed through and didn't pay any attention, flunked geometry. But I had two teachers in particular that changed my life. A guy named Frank Wyland, my English teacher. And he knew that I was struggling at home because my dad and I were really butting heads all the time. And he threw me out of the house. My senior year, he threw me out. And I lived in a boarding house, or the basement, on a cot with six other rock truck drivers. And I paid her $6 a week that I made pumping gas at Pete's Standard Station. And that's how I finished high school. Oh, well, right up until like the last week and a half. My mom made my dad come get me. And so anyway, I'm sleeping in this boarding house. So Frank Wyland, for whatever reason, took an interest in me. And at the end of every class, in English class, instead of that nonsense of breaking down sentence structures, and as you well know, I can't form a sentence today. I can't write a paragraph. I don't know where they start and why they end. I don't. I can communicate with the best of them, but I can't write sentences. And Frank Wyland would tell me, "Mr. Hansen, get up," and I'd start walking to the front of the class. And he said, "Today's topic, Vietnam. Should we stay or should we go?" "Go. You got 5 minutes." And then the next day, "Mr. Hansen, civil rights issues, Lester Maddox, you know, in Georgia, right or wrong? Go." And then some days it was, "Hey, Dale, do Johnny Carson's monologue," because I idolized the great late night talk show host, Johnny Carson. He said, "I know you stayed up last night to watch it," and I do Johnny Carson's monologue. Howard DeWild, on the other hand, had a class, I think it was called like civics or American history or something. But most of his class was just philosophical arguments about the history of America. Mm-hmm. Now, it turned out he was kind of a nut job, and he ran off with a student years later. So I'm hardly using him as the teacher you need to get. But his classes were fascinating, because he would just throw it open for debate, and we would think and argue and talk. And he would bring us, hopefully, the historical facts in some cases. Well, this is where I get in trouble with the teachers, if they're listening out there now. I'm 73 years old. I made a lot of money in my life. I've done a lot of things in my life as a result of what I learned in high school after flunking geometry. Because I took typing too to make up for my geometry to graduate. I type like 70 words a minute. I type every day of my life. Every day of my life. Philosophy arguments is the driving argument behind what I write in my commentaries.
Right.
Nobody has ever asked me, how long actually is the third side of that triangle? It's never come up. In 73 years, 56 years out of high school, nobody has ever said, how long is the third side of that triangle? I hire people to do that. I hire them to do that. And I wish we would get back to that, of making kids open their minds and debate and communicate, which I still think is the single best thing I ever learned in high school, was to lose all the fear of public speaking. Jerry Seinfeld does a great joke about this. I don't know if you heard this or not. But they did this survey, and I think it's legit, that they did a survey, like the single biggest fear that people had in life, and number one was public speaking, mm-hmm. and number two was dying. Those were the two, right? You know this?
Yeah.
The two biggest fears in America. And as Seinfeld says, so what that means is, the person who's speaking and giving the eulogy at the funeral would rather be in the box.
Well, we got to wrap it up. I think this would have been easier to do a year ago when you had a schedule.
Yeah. I warned you.
You did. He's got nothing to do.
I've been home for, what is it now? Going on for about 6 months, and I don't get to talk to anybody. So once you open the possibility up, I said, look out. I will just like be out like a running river here with all my nonsense, you know.
Well, I am glad that you are here, and I'm so happy that you decided to come in and join us.
It is, as you pointed out, it is, as the lovely Mrs. Hansen always says, it is my favorite topic. But I think more importantly than that, I hope if they can kind of sift through the bio on occasion there, I think there's a message in there that a kid can learn a little bit from. And I always leave them with this thought at every banquet speech I've given to the high school kids. I had an old fat guy speak at my high school banquet too, and I didn't listen to him. But I speak at a banquet, I said, I'm just trying to reach two or three of you. And this is another thing I think we make a mistake about, whether it's politics, you know, where the politicians, they want to appeal to everybody. Well, those days are gone. If they ever were, those days are gone. And I think the teachers, I tell my teachers, my daughter and her daughter, you're just not going to get them all. You're just not. Now, that doesn't mean you just ignore them. Doesn't mean you give up on them. But you can't go home and cry into your pillow because three of the kids flunked. Mm-hmm. You have to take the satisfaction of those that you reached. And that's where I say to the kids, you don't offend me when you turn away and act bored because you're not buying into my principle. But as you've heard this speech before, and if I could, I'd like to leave them with this. High school is the only thing we do in life that you can only do once. It's the only thing that we give you one opportunity to go to high school and never again. Now, you go out of high school and you go to college and you don't like the college you went to, you can get another one. You don't go to college, you can go back when you're 30, 50, or 75. Mm-hmm. You get a job, you don't like it, you can get another one. You get buy a house, you don't like it, you move. You get a car, you don't like it, you trade it in. You get married, you don't like the woman you're married to, you can get another one. Now, I don't recommend that to the boys out there because it'll cost you a fortune. But I do tell the girls, if you don't like the guy you're married to, you can dump him and get another one and take him for every dollar he's got on the way out the door. Every single thing you do in life, you can fix it, you can change it, and you can make it right. Every single thing, except high school. If you skip the high school senior prom like I did, there's never another one. If you miss homecoming night, there's never another one. Mm. If you miss the graduation ceremony, there's never another one. You don't go to the pep rallies, there won't be any more. High school is one opportunity and one opportunity only. Because everything else in life will allow you to fix it, will allow you to change it, will allow you to make it better. And as I say to kids, I know some of your, if they're listening now, that old man doesn't have a clue. Yeah, but what if I'm right? What if I am right? And you dedicate yourself to enjoying every single day of high school. Then you're lucky. What if I'm wrong? Oh, well, then you dedicated yourself to every single day of high school.
That's right.
And you get on with the rest of your life. If I'm totally wrong about this, the worst thing that happens is you had a pretty good high school run. But if I'm right, and you don't think I am, so you then blow it off, like in many cases I did, we never allow you to come back and fix it. We never do. And I wish, I just wish I'd have known that when I was 16 years old. Mm-hmm. I really do. I still would have flunked geometry, but the rest of it would have been pretty good.
That is former WFA sports anchor Dale Hansen. Thanks for sharing your time and all those opinions with us.
It's my pleasure. Anytime. Anytime.
If you're listening or watching, would like to reach out to us, you know how to do it by now. It's the email address is letstalk@mesquiteisd.org, or you can find us on social media using the hashtag LetMISD. For Dr. LaDonna Gully, and to quote Dale, for everyone who's been a part of this one, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.